Recording in progress. Progress. Okay, so today, as you all know, we have a reading from the one and only Phil Taggart, who tells me he has three collections of poetry and an art book called Cowboy Collages. And we know that Phil's been editing poetry for over 20 years. For Art Life limited edition, and with Marsha for Askew Poetry Journal, and more recently for Spillway. He teaches, has taught poetry workshops, as we know, at Cal Lutheran and the University of Pittsburgh and in local high schools. He works with CAPS Media and elementary schools as well, teaches broadcast digital media at El Camino High School. At Ventura College. And this is the bit that I love. He's run and supported poetry readings in Ventura County and Santa Barbara since 1991, and hosts, as we know, the E.P. Foster reading. Now, 1991 is 30 years ago, Phil. That means that this is the 30th anniversary, and I looked up what 30th anniversary is, and it's Pearl. So, and it's appropriate, isn't it, that for all of that time, we've been privileged to listen to the pearls from firstly the pen and latterly the keyboard of Mr. Phil Taggart. On a personal note too, I'd like to say that he's been hugely influential for me and has helped me to host readings in California and now here in the UK. So I'm eternally grateful for his support. And I'm sure that there are a great many other people who would say exactly the same. So I'm delighted, honored, and thrilled to welcome Phil Taggart and invite you to unmute yourself, Phil, and take it away.
Let the games begin. I want to thank you, Ken, for inviting me to read here. It's an honor I finally get to read internationally, albeit on Zoom. And when I started hosting readings and such, I had hair. So a long time ago. The readings I'm going to read are from my new book, which is about to come out, called Walking the Dog in a Time of Rage. And there's going to be some... I'm using Mothra in many of the poems, and some of you may know, you may not, that Mothra is in the Godzilla movies, and she is the one that her job is to try to save the world. And the Luminous Twins are the little twins, little fairies that are on her back. Also, I'm a big fan of Neil Gaiman, and so I have a Satyr who is still around because he is immortal. And he's going to show up. And he's actually gotten a little nicer in all these years. He kind of grew up, as some of us who may have been satyrs in our earlier life realize that you actually have to grow up one day. So here you go with the title poem for the book that's about to come out. Walking, oops, and I am going to keep time on myself because I have no idea how much time I'm going to take. Hopefully not too long. Walking the dog in a time of rage. The minivan screams by, horn blaring, angry fist out the window. I must have done something wrong. Rage has become our discourse, our answer. Anger, our voice sputtering away in the ether, on the highways, in the ballot box. We're driving through a park, not a very big one. Only one entrance, one parking lot. We're both approaching. I wonder if he's going to the farmer's market too. My friends online nip at each other. Clever quips bite. I pass his vehicle, drive to the other side of the parking lot as far away as possible. This anger swirls inside. We don't know what to do. A white man in his 40s gets out of the van, sets his dachshund down, pulls a baseball bat from the back of his seat, looks at me. Martha and I go look for Brussels sprouts. But part of me wants to stay. I'm angry too. Walk over to him. Isn't that how it's supposed to be? Celebrate this rage, consecrate it with our blood on the ground flowing. We find yellow squash instead. On the other side of the park, there's the man, his dachshund, his baseball bat. Now, this one is called Confusing the Faithful. And you probably saw her. She was in Portland, and she was naked, and she was on the news. And here's a quote from the LA Times. Out of Portland, tear grass, an apparition emerges. Confusing the faithful with an epigraph from Pope Francis, of course. You must give the solid food of faith to the people of God, not feed the people of God disputed questions, because that confused them. Pope Francis, 2019. Sorry, I forget about that. She walks nude to the middle of the street. In Portland, they call her Athena. But maybe she's Inanna, back from the dead, the first way to roll away the stone. In Florida, a new golden calf is formed. The rage primal express Callie. She comes face to face with a wall of police. The calf rises. An absurd comb over melds into an Elvis pompadour. Shiny flag surfer bro shorts, even flip flops. She says, this fury in me, I want to be naked. I want to confront them. A rubber bullet strikes her foot. She sits down, spreads her legs, the fury, the sacred. Sheila Nagig, go ahead, shoot this. The golden one is worshiped at CPAC in Orlando, politically sacred. Moses scratches his head. White Jesus joins the crowd. Isis, Hel, Amartasu, Ishel, Inanna, Sheila Nagig, Kali, Kuan Yin, Athena. Okay, this is one, thank you. This is one I wrote a while ago for my brother, and it came in a dream, and he's gone now, so I'm gonna read this. It's called Dreamtime, and this is for all of you who have not been to Los Angeles. The 101 is kind of like a big river that runs through it. It's a freeway. So it's called Dreamtime and the 101. Just past the 405 going south, a new Dharma bum stickered hybrid SUV passes us. Last night, I dreamt of Rick. In the upstairs room on the left, a hidden room always there. Passing Vivid, the Ford Theater, I saw the Pogues there. Graffiti crosses, knocked down road signs. In the dream, Rick is leaving. I gather up what is needed. Our paths are so close, brothers. We cross into Hollywood, the Knickerbocker, the Beatles' capital, more crosses, Shangri-La Lodge, Destiny Inn, the crush of downtown. We're on parallel paths, like moving sidewalks drawn close. We touch, then drift apart. Gronk and Springsteen, Spring Street, J-Town, Aztlan, Brew 102 and beautiful bridges. Rick, Rampart and Tommy's. I wave, the car hurtles down past the 605, South Whittier and on. Rick is absorbed in distance. He waves back, goodbye. Thank you. I've been writing some poems on walking. I hurt myself. I tore my Achilles tendon about a year ago, a little over a year ago, and I hadn't been able to walk. And so I wrote some poems about walking. And this one is Still Walking 2021. We're in bed early, New Year's Eve, ready for 2020 to end. Awake at midnight, mostly gunshots fill the air. The rain stops out the door, walking. A drizzle, really, sidewalk, gray, mottled, shiny. Ankle still hurts. I can walk farther now, have to, don't want my muscles to stop. The US Capitol is invaded. Angry white folks trash the place, steal what they can. The circus came home. My new shoes help, a balance between support and freedom. My ankle moves protected around the block again. 2 weeks later, inauguration. armed troops line the route, riot fence topped with razor wire. Hope is a poet praying unity. At the top of the hill, I turn left, peer over the Oxnard plain, walking home, push my ankle, my heart. Yeah, it hurts. I hear it snowing in Santa Paula. Now the first of the Mothra poems. This is Mothra and the Luminous Twins before the movies. The twins told her stories when she was larvae, stories of Earth and all who reside here. Mothra mostly ate, ready for change. The twins sang dreams to her pupa. Cocoon, premonition, vibrated through the hardened shell. Hiroshima, Nagasaki, Bikini flashed through Mothra's psalm-fortified cocoon. Radiation immersed the naked pupa. She emerged imago, an adult engaged in pain, enraged in pain. Mothra arose through searing light, her vision in pupa expanding. White blinds me, snow falls, all around cinder dust gripped. Her burn peels my skin. And all the Mothra poems are actually haiku or haibun. So it's a poem and then a little haiku at the end. And here's the first Saturn poem. The Saturn and the Moon. He called in sick so as to meet her. Luna, Selene, Artemis, Diana, Moon. The Saturn drives small roads, rolling hills just north of Buellton, out away from human light. Blue, snow. Worm, pink, flower, moon. After the first millennia, he moved into town. A millennia after that, he just tried to fit in, not be noticed, but sometimes he remembers. Harvest, super, hunter, sturgeon, strawberry, moon. The Saturn stops the car, turns off the lights, carries a camp chair, a six pack to the top of the hill. Plow, cold, lotus, wolf, moon. Unfolds and sets the chair just right. Sits back, cracks open a beer, lights a cigarette, and contemplates the moon. She is sitting on the sidewalk, collapsed into stucco, wall of a bike shop. She says hi when we pass. Sweet voice, red hair. A woman passed her before us, eyes concerned, looked back. The girl tilts her head up, smile, scabs, freckles cover her face. She's new, the homeless tan hasn't darkened, toughened her skin. Red shirt bike patrol calling for help, calling the police. The girl lifts up off the sidewalk, straightens, gathers her stuff, walks on. She's maybe 16. Okay, here's another walking poem. Thank you very much. My phone actually turned, okay, great. My phone turned off on me, you know how that is. So there's this wonderful place to walk really close to where Marcia and I live, and it's called Harmon Canyon. And once I was able to walk around the block quite a bit, I started walking in Harmon Canyon. And this is called Walking in Harmon Canyon 1. Slog up the canyon a few miles from home, building strength today. Yes, there is pain, but mostly it's old man pain. The drought keeps the hills brown. Never got green this year. My past is online waving at me, nostalgia and rage. Like to walk in the morning before it gets hot. Pass the WW2 era, Jeep abandoned, rusted down, a place for kids to play. The uneven ground helps my balance, take off at a quick pace. Of course, everyone passes me, just happy to walk again. There's a warlord in Reading. His acolytes beat a black man. He watches. Feels good trudging up this dirt road, pushing myself past the old tractor, also erodes back to the earth. At the top of the canyon, someone has built a giant roadrunner, holy icon, it watches us. it seems there's a connection, the Klan, the police, the military. Oh my. Reach the turnaround point and I do. Local cross-country teams have passed me once, twice, sometimes three times by now. Jim Crow is making a comeback in legislatures all across the country, even the Supreme Court. Strength wanes, stumble back to the car. I sweat happiness, I sweat caution. The canyon holds its breath, no rain, waiting for fire. Now it's Mothra, the twins, and the movies. The luminous twins loved the movies, flickering lights and shadow, and they were loved. Fantasy violence disturbed Mothra, but the twins are stars. The press follows them, record contracts. While on the Godzilla set, Mothra reads Silent Spring. Rachel Carson's book is alarmist, the director says. We have time to fix this. We don't, Mothra replies. We have nothing. Stillwater pesticide, better living through chemistry. Then we fade away. Okay, this is on 99. This is the San Joaquin Valley, and 99 is the freeway that runs through it. Around Selma, Jesus is Lord, breast augmentation, billboard side by side. A mile on, we see that Madame Sophie will tell you. The truth is Jesus, or maybe it is bigger and bigger, but possibly it's both. Okay, here's another Mothra. Mothra, a book deal and the Amazon. Mothra wings across the Pacific, the rainforest, 40,000 fires last year. The luminous twins discuss green economy, pro-business, deforestation, beef replacing trees, wind power, short-term profits over clean air. The twins are excited, a pop culture book deal. Mothra says, the book deal means we're over. Not true, the twins say, it's world. Affirmation, healing, awareness. They all descend the Amazon, smoke on the horizon. The air purified trees full of grace for sale, mass extinction. Now the Satyrs go to the mall. Seems they like to show up in a group, and they this is kind of a group that they show up in. They're kind of they're kind of in charge in a way. So the Satyrs are at the mall. They park their cars at the edge of the mall, approach the temple, high holy days, acolytes enter, the Satyrs follow. These days, a few millennia later, the Satyrs just fit in, rarely see each other, but sometimes are called. Pan is with the elves, leaning against, waiting for Whitebeard. Torgo is meditating on the US flag just above Whitebeard's throne altar. Prayers of children are spoken. The elves chant their hosannas. Baby shark dancing doll, walking Buzz Lightyear, mystery stuffed animals, hand operated drone, cheaper than dirt, AR-15 rifles. The Satyrs bear witness. All invocations are heard. This mystical and temporal dilemma, this children's consumer supplication, leaves the earth poisoned. The Satyrs miss the forest, retire to a sports bar, remember trees. Okay, Californians will get this. And I don't know, I don't think it's gonna go all the way to England. This is Cal Worthington was a big commercial thing that happened in California. So this is Go See Cal. Old jalopy's on the blink, Go See Cal. It's later than you think, Go See Cal. Cal Worthington TV commercial. He calls back to us through the ether, across the somatic divide. You too can have this American dream, buy this car, drive this asphalt. I will stand upon my head to sell a car. I will stand upon my head till my ears are turning red. Go see cow, go see cow, go see cow. Cal drifts west across the desert from the heartland to the promised one. Heat shimmering visions of Aztlan, Angeline, Surf City, giant blue pyramids and single family tract homes. He touched us in this holy land, sealed in concrete with bikinis, and once upon a time tattooed across dreamy blue raster abundance, complete with palm trees shimmering, swaying with his dog Spot. Okay, this is Walking Harmon Canyon 2, as an epigraph by Laurie Anderson. Paradise is exactly where you are right now, only much, much better. Lengthening my stride today, a glorious dead tree beckons me into the canyon like Brazil's Christ the Redeemer, Cristo Redentor. Recently, in the sequoias, walking with friends, they slow to my pace. I'm still quite slow. Driving back to Visalia, see a large blue on white flag with an assault rifle on it, a small town's community center. In Harmon Canyon, Coyote trots across the dirt path, looks at me, looks back at mountain bikes jingling in the distance. Maybe the same one at the cabin built in the 20s, tore down in the 50s, only part of a mortared stone wall there now. A man, Jesus for Trump, t-shirt is begging near the driveway at the local Target. Anything helps. Could be Odin's tree. Wonder if the wisdom happened here. Walking through fire blackened oaks, many are returning green, many don't. Walk a slow ascension, nice pace. I sweat, red tails circle above the power lines. Laurie Anderson's song rolls around in my head. Everybody on the island was screaming, look at me, look at me, look at me. Feet scrape the ground, heading back the parking lot, a wonder walking here. Bumper stickers, a car from Texas, an assault rifle next to Jesus as Lord. Jesus, Trump, guns, amen. Okay, this is a Satyr poem again. Satyr's back by himself. The Satyr sleeps in light raining. This is about the Perseid meteor showers. He drives Old Woman Springs Road looking for a place free of man's light. Once the Satyr floated on his back in Palm Springs in a pool. Perseid rain, light and water, salt, buoyant like a dream, it quiets him. He remembers Perseus from back then. The man was angry, violent. The Satyr was probably drunk. That was a millennia ago. They changed, they grew up. He's taking time off work, driving the Mojave Lucerne Valley landers. A dirt road aims right past it all. He parks, carries an old canvas cot, camp chair, six pack of beer, climbs a small rise, sets camp, thinks about humans growing up. He is the pine, canvas stretches, and he encounters stardust burning. Occasional coyotes howl, and of course, gunshots, always gunshots. Okay. I see something I have to change. I'll do that later. Okay. I Want to Be Sedated. This was a B-side the boys recorded in 78. It's on my car radio, K Earth Oldies 101, as I drive into work. Turned up to drown out, to drown out. The LA Times, an extra edition, 2 days in a row, mass killings, mass killings. Although the tune became a staple for the Ramones, arguably their most popular, didn't make the charts back then. A man with a gun walks into a room, shooting, week after week of police killings, mass killings. The song was about touring too much, overwhelmed, overworked, and only working. Rage and fear turned off social discourse. No discussion, no compromise. This is a riot in slow motion. The radio algorithms, the continually plop, I want to be sedated in my car, makes sense, especially now. 24 hours ago, I want to be sedated. I want to be sedated. Close with this one. Sometimes I'm just lucky. An email tells me the FBI discovered through the intelligence monitoring network, I am eligible for, have a lawful right to, a gold smart card, number 51208156-1062. The sky is blue, a beautiful blue. Helicopters are out and the drones chatter away. There is the mandatory one-time fee I have to pay before I can receive the card. Then 2 to 3 working days later, my card will arrive. Of course, I have to pay for shipping, but I can use this card all over the planet. Today, the drones talk to me. Usually they just buzz around, sparkle in the sun, glow in the moonlight. Finally, I am to contact the Seattle office of the FBI Department of Homeland Security, courier and director, distribution officer, Mr. Thompson at yahoo.com. All the voices connect me, sparking off in my head, warm, comfort, reason. It all makes sense now. Thank you very much.
Wow. Okay, unmute if you'd like to talk to Phil and congratulate him. Phil, I just want to thank you so much for a wonderful reading. I'm sure the book, you can't wait to see the book when it's out. When is it being published? Is it ready?
It should be out. I think I'll have it probably by October.
Fantastic. Can't wait. So that'll be a must get for all of us. So we can read again those poems and more. Phil, is wonderful. Thank you so much. We are all so lucky. Thank you.
Thank you, Phil.
Thank you, Kim.
Thanks, Phil. That was fantastic. Thank you so much. Excellent.
Phil, who's the publisher of your book?
Who are the details?
Brandenburg Press. It's Christopher Buckley's publication house, which is his house.
looking forward to, I'm so looking forward to seeing the book, and it was wonderful hearing you, Phil. You really are not just the poet laureate of Ventura County, but I would nominate you for poet laureate of California.
That sounds like a curse to me.
Wonderful, Phil.
That would be great.
Strong content and humor. I mean, it was great, really left me with a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Jean. I really think, yes, go ahead, Weezy, I'm sorry.
Oh yeah, I love your line, he's absorbed in distance. I thought that was a brilliant line, I love it. And your poem about insurrection, I hear it's snowing in Santa Paula, I thought was a brilliant ending.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, I loved it. Thanks.
Okay.
Well, thank you, Phil. Really enjoyed it.
Thanks, Tina.
And you showed me California. You know, you did such an array of California that, you know, I don't know about. You know,
scary, isn't it?
Yes. I mean, Jesus and the breast enhancements, my God.
Thank you, Phil. You gave me reminders of why I don't miss it.
Now we know why Jamie is in Ireland.
Yeah.
I liked the Phil. I thought the poem about the homeless girl was really lovely. It's very sad, and I love the final line. Maybe she was 16. I think it was.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Really wonderful. Thank you.
Okay.
Phil, I love.
Go on.
Sorry. I love the way that you combine like fact with insight. Like, it'll be observation, and then you just slip in these little like these little gems of
gems.
Yeah.
Insight. You know, it's beautiful. I really appreciate your reading.
Well, I think we'll leave. Can we leave it there? Because it's appropriate that Jen should be the last speaker, because most of you now are aware that the third Wednesday of every month is when this Zoom meeting occurs and this Zoom reading happens. And it just happens that September's reader is none other than Ms. Jennifer Kelly. So make sure you tune in on, I think it's the 15th, it's early, the third Wednesday is early in September. So it'll be the same link, Wheezy, whichever link you find works.
I'll have to, I knew it was all the same, but
One works. Yeah. So it's the same link, and it's please the same link. Tune in to listen to Jen in a month's time. Now we also, those of you who are more local to where we are, I am in Chichester. You heard it here first, and take a note, September the 26th, which is a Sunday, in the afternoon, we have a reading in the park, which will be fun, in Priory Park in Chichester, in the center of Chichester. So we will have a reading in Priory Park, Chichester. So anybody that wants to come to that, please do. More information will follow, but there will be in due course information on the Words Out Loud website. So if you want to find wordsoutloud.org.uk, that's where you will eventually find information about that. And speaking of book publishing, our own Tina has a book which is published, and there's a book signing, I understand, in Leon Solent, Tina. Congratulations, and we will flock to that. Please tell us where it is and when it is.
It's on Saturday the 25th of September between 10 and 2 o'clock. The bookshop is a really nice little bookshop, actually, in Leon Solent, which has improved immeasurably since I was a child. It's actually quite a nice place to visit now. There's lots
you mean Leon Solent rather than the bookshop, right?
Yeah. I don't have fond memories of Leon Solent when I was a kid, but it's really nice, actually. It's nice for walks, nice little cafes and shops. The bookshop is lovely. And the Sarah Vine, the owner, seems to be very welcoming of self-published and local writers. And there's a really great selection of books there. So it's worth going along and having a chat with her. As I said, she's always up to something, puts on lots of events. She's very up for connections. So,
what's the name of the bookshop, Tina?
It's called The Bookshop.
Oh. Why?
Oh, there you go. Fancy that.
She doesn't waste time on, you know, imagining.
So, okay, that's great.
Yeah. So, yeah, it'd be good to see any faces. Brilliant. Thank you.
Okay, brilliant. Thank you. And I don't know if anyone has any other items of news or interest. I would say from our point of view, from the point of view of Words Out Loud, which is our equivalent of the Ventura County Poetry Project, we now have an active website up and running, courtesy of Mike. Well done. Take a bow, Mike. Thank you. And that's he's put the web address on the chat. So please take time to visit that and see what we're up to. It will be growing. We will be putting more stuff up there as we get more and more things going on. But we're beginning to get readings and other stuff happening. So, and we very much see ourselves as as a sister group to the Ventura County Poetry Project. So we feel we have so much in common with you guys. Okay, so let's start the open mic, if we may, please. And there have been one or two who've joined since we were, while Phil was reading. Jan, I see you've joined. Do you want to, are you reading tonight, Jan?
I'm so sorry, I can't. I have got to go out. It's, you know, 11 o'clock here, so I've got to take care of some stuff.
Okay, okay, that's great, no problem.
I love this, though. I'll be on time next time.
Nobody gets told off or a detention or anything. It's you turn up when you turn
May
up.
May I
it's
be invited good. Back?
Hi, everybody Katie, is welcome at all times. I think we all know that by now. I think we do.
Hi, David.
Susie, hello. I see Susie is here, but I don't see Susie. I don't know if you are receiving. Oh, there we are. Would you like to read?
Thank you. I'd love to listen. Thank you so much. You're doing a great job, and thank you for asking.
No, you're welcome, and welcome. So, okay. So let's, without further ado, I'm going to mute you all again, and I shall invite people at random to unmute themselves and to read a poem. We all know the rules. Phil made the rules. We just reiterate them. One poem, no epics, we mean it. So that's the way we roll. So I'd like to start. I think let's invite Elaine. I think I'd like to invite you to unmute and kick us off.
All right, good day to you all, everybody. You can hear me okay?
Yep.
Great, okay. My poem, a few details. I mentioned Cheeseman, it's a park in Denver. And I mentioned Walter, who was an old boyfriend. So the name of my poem is Naked in the Park with Walter. If I could call you back, I would. To the time we ran naked in Cheeseman, shedding our clothes before curfew, leaves fallen from the trees. If I could call you back to run with me, I would, laughing over the cold ground, dodging itinerant piles of November snow, the chill on our skin glorious, days burdens exfoliated, the dark pines, a silent witness to our revels, to our hapless youth, at that bracing moment of freedom before time found us out on this moonless night. What were we thinking? What did we want? Too shy to look directly at our naked gamboling in that clear, clean air. If I could recall you, I would. So many questions unanswered. Our lives dreamed by the night, stirred by the wind among the pines, kissing our skin. Then your own kisses under a tree, taking my shoulders in your hands, sonorous, as if the wind and owl approved, as if beauty would last forever. Once in Manhattan, I thought I saw you in Washington Square, surrounded by people. Your handsome face, a shooting star. Thank you.
Thank you, Elaine. Thank you so much. You're welcome. Wonderful. Okay. So now we're up and running. I would like to follow that. Can we invite Karen, known as Kaza, to read next? Kaz, you're up.
Thank you. Elaine, that was lovely, and Phil, I loved your reading, and I'm glad your ankle is healed, and you're getting around. It actually spurred so much wonderful poetry. So this one is about a little girl who lives in our neighborhood. It's called Ellery. She runs. She sees me and runs over, throws herself at me and wraps her arms and legs around my lower torso. She infects me with her grin as wide as a canyon and as deep. "You don't have to hold on to me," she says. "I can hold on to you." We are best buds with a common buddy, Polly, a big stuffed polar bear that lives on my bed. We've made her elaborate homes from pillows and blankets and supervised visits by other creatures left in my daughter's bedroom. We taped paper wings on all of them so they could fly like the adventurous pup in the children's book I once read to her on the wood bench by our front door, unknowingly cementing a bond. She herself is altogether bird-like. I watch her from my office window, running up and down the sidewalk, barely touching down, looking ready to take wing at any moment. Her joy of life is contagious, stirs memories of my childhood days where life was all about running, jumping, and playing out fantasies that were as real as the fairy homes we built, wrapping ourselves around our make-believe worlds and holding on for as long as we could.
Thank you, Kaz. Okay, thank you very much. Next up, it's going to be Bonnie.
Is this working? Yes, okay, thank you. Okay, so I recently, quote, celebrated a birthday, and this is how I felt about it. At 78, I don't feel like celebrating my birthday this year, same as last year, when the pandemic threatened all our lives before the vaccines were widely available. But now we are still living with it in a new variant form, even more contagious than the last. On top of that, watching the horrible scenes on TV of the Taliban taking over Afghanistan after our 20-year battle there to fight the terrorists and bring democracy to that place, to see it all disappear in a matter of weeks, and fear that the women will be driven back into their homes, out of schools and jobs, only allowed outside covered in burqas and accompanied by a man or even a young boy. The state of our own democracy is now threatened too, haunted by the specter of the January 6th attack on our Capitol and the losing party trying to restrict the voting rights of the other and gerrymandering as many districts as they can get away with. Each side hates the other, and by association, wearing masks and getting vaccinated have become politically divisive too, instead of being seen as public health issues. All of this against the threatening backdrop of climate change, fires and drought, especially in our Western states. When will we decide at least to establish desalination plants along our Pacific coast to alleviate our dwindling water supply? Then there is my ever-aging body, whose different parts seem to need more care or repair every day. Things I took for granted when I was young are now more difficult, if not impossible. I regret that I did not appreciate the vigor of youth that allowed me to keep changing my life, attending different schools, traveling wherever I wanted to go, trying new careers and romantic relationships. How lucky I was to be able to have a child at 45, spending time with moms so much younger than me that I forgot I was supposed to be middle-aged by then. Are all the good times really behind me now, as I struggle to complete the projects on my list, looking anxiously at the calendar, wondering if I'll have time to finish them before I go? Forget about celebrating this birthday. I want to stop the clock rather than watch the countdown to another year. Thank you. By the way, I am next Wednesday, at our 6 o'clock reading at the Thousand Oaks Poetry Library, which is now online. I will be the featured reader, and I would love it if any of you are interested in coming. I know it'll be the middle of the night. It's some god-awful time then, but I'd love to have anybody.
6 o'clock.
Hopefully Ken can make it. I know he can stay up late. But in addition to reading some of my poetry, I'm going to be reading some excerpts from my World War II book that I've been writing forever that actually will be published by the spring, and it's about my father's experience as a GI, who, by the way, spent several months in England and Scotland during his service. So anyway,
well,
thanks.
6 a.m. is 6 p.m. is 2 a.m. here, so we'll see what we can do, Bonnie.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so I would like to invite next, I think, Kevin Patrick Sullivan from SLO. Welcome.
Well, can you hear me all right?
We can hear you.
All right. Well, this was a Bukowski tribute.
Are you wanting to get your picture there?
This was a Bukowski tribute, the title of the poem is from a Bukowski's. 7th race, when the angels swung low and burned, but I only use when the angels swung low and burned. I can hear it in her voice, the scatter of burned cigarettes, the clinking of empty glasses, working through the night. She no longer shines unless lit from the outside. She is so tired. She is ready to leave this world. Spontaneously combust, if only you strike the match. Anyway, thank you very much.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you very much.
I really did like your reading, and Granberg Press was beautiful.
Right. Great to see you, Kevin. Thank you. Thank you for joining. Next up, please, I would like to invite Sue to unmute.
Hello, everybody.
Hi, Sue.
Hi. Hi. This is a poetic monologue. It's about a fairy queen who's stolen a baby, and I have the baby beside me. So... hush now, hush. What is this guilt that cloaks me with unending night? A voice that snarls and poisons from within. It's not mine. When I was once abandoned and left to wander through the tangled streets of time, there was no happy face to rouse me from my waking dream. I suffered, drifted and deserted, without hope of rescue or result. And life was cruel. And make no mistake, I cannot, I will not step back from the path that I have chosen, yet still I question. And the doubts, like feathered demons, black and brilliant, give me no rest, and thus I am all resolve and blunder. Oh, and now you look at me with love, an expectation of a life to come, which is your right, and I'm all doubt. Oh. Know that I have forever dreamed of this. I taste and savor the sweetness in every waking moment. I hold a winning hand to checkmate and challenge the mortal man that I called love. At least, at last, he who haunts my memory shall feel my loss. And yet I can see nothing of him in you. That confounds me. You confound me. I do not even know your given name. So tiny, but so filled with light expanding. I feel that energy of life. It touches tender places within my soul. Oh, she smiles. even now in the shallows of her slumber. If I could only sleep as you do. Oh, but no, I puzzle then create. Why? I crave the peace of innocence, and yet my actions betray me. Is it my nature over which I have no counsel, or is it my restless, unbridled thoughts that dictate a perilous path which can bring me no peace? Whatever the result, I think I cannot do this thing. No, it's all clear to me now. You are not mine, and this way is madness. And the sun is not yet risen. The spell still hangs fragile in a memory that daylight will surely harden and destroy. I must hurry you home before you're missed. Oh, I hear something. Is that you? Oh, dear God, I am undone. Thank you. It's finished.
Thank you, Sue. That was great. Thank you very much. It was lovely. Okay. Next, I would like to invite Jean, please. I've lost you. Where were you?
Hi, am I around?
We've got you. You're on.
Okay. Again, thank you, Phil. And I wanted to announce on September 14th, Phil Taggart is going to be the engineer and they running a Loose Lips. We've come out of the closet and we're doing our second online Zoom event, and Gail Vronsky from Topanga, some of you may know her poetry, and Diane Delgado will be the poets. It's September 14th, right before your reading in the morning, Phil, Ken, and it's at 6 p.m. So I'm going to take you all to Bogota, Colombia, 1955. And there's one word in Spanish. It's about, centers on my first visit there, a bullfight. And muleta, the word muleta in Spanish is a stick covered with a red cloth used in the final third of the bullfight to tempt the bull to charge. Exotica in Bogota, Colombia, 1955. The mellifluous songs of João Gilberto serenading in Portuguese catapults me to the joys of dancing. I mambo cha-cha, merengue samba, those couple dances my then boyfriend exported from Bogota, where he grew up after he and his parents escaped Nazi Europe. Oh, the wonders he introduced me to when I visited Bogota when I was 17, like the great Luis Miguel Dominguín and bullfighting, a pas de deux between matador and bull. Oh, the blazing pageantry, the glittering costumes. Dominguín shakes the fire red cape as the bull paws the sand, flaunts the muleta again, and the bull charges. Dominguín bends back, executes a Veronica, a basic pass. The bull thunders under the cloak so close it could rip this toreador's thigh. The grace of Dominguín's twisted arch back, his ribcage splayed open to the gods, and from the sold out stadium, oceanic waves of ole, ole, again pawing the sand, again the daring arch back and passes, again the oles as this Molotov cocktail of beauty and terror and the tension between the two upended my naive American world. The street food my steady proudly introduced me to, things he missed in America when high school, now college, called fried pork rind or chicharron, addictive as potato chips, the smell of frying donuts, and my confusion why Bogotanos held eucalyptus leaves under their noses to cure colds, he said, frequent in this gray, wet climate, 7,000 feet above sea level. At meals, my boyfriend's Polish parents ping-ponged in six languages, he in French, Spanish, and English, while his younger sister swam in the latter two. As their borderless grammar spilled from one into the other, I thank them for unlocking my dream to seek a bigger world.
Thanks, Jean. Thank you. Okay, so next I would like to call on, please, I think we'll call on Dennis.
This was,
there you are.
Yes, got this out of the newspaper. There's no author and no title. And it goes like this. It was in the entertainment section of the classifieds. There once was a lady named Sue who had nothing whatever to do and who did it so badly, I thought she would gladly have stopped before she was through. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you, Dennis. Okay, so who am I going to select to follow that one? I think it's Jamie. Touch of the Irish.
Okay, thank you all. Thanks so much, Phil, for that reading and for all your service to poetry and Kevin Patrick Sullivan, you as well. You guys have done so much. Number. These days, I've been counting trees and their places. I counted 17 different trees in 5 places. That was before I counted the leaflets of the compound leaves of ash and rowan. That was before I counted those trees on the far side of the sheep wire fence that bounds the orchard. I counted the trees twice last week. In my dream, I am still counting. In my dream, I count you among the living. I counted on you among the living without counting the living. These days I am where I used to count time to the place where I count this day. I stopped minding the official count. I am minding it again. Variations reveal themselves in the way the spacing and shape of leaflets tell me rowan from ash. These days, I see this is how I count trees and friends who stiffened like trees. These days, I count them with the dying cells I shed in sleep. They are the leaves I count. I count them in groves, columns of salt.
Thank you, Jamie. Thank you so much. Lovely to have you with us. Next up, it's Rebecca.
Okay, well, this is a poem I wrote last year about courgettes. Because there are a lot of them at the moment.
Zucchini. Zucchini in Californian.
Okay. With green reptilian skin, they grow thick and fast over mottled leaves. The sun dances a pattern, and shadows lurk in their folds, extending and exploring in their vegetable bed. Stems bulge in vulgarity, ripe and heavy and ready to be twisted. Flowers hide like shy ballerinas in a delicate sunset, color of cantaloupe melon, glowing like a paper lantern, bright orange stars, waiting in a forest of stems.
Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you very much. Okay. What am I going to do next? Next, I think, Wheezy, I think it's time.
Maybe you can help me out on this, everyone. I thought I was attempting to do my first haikus, but a poet friend of mine said that haikus have to be about nature. So she said, what I've written is called Senaku or something like that, S-E-N-R-Y-U. Is anybody, anyway, okay, well, I'll just call them haikus because I don't know if she was right. My first attempt, okay, here we go. And I have two of them, but it's only six lines.
Okay.
So, Thunderbolt romance, all remembered, well cherished, he is still a thrill. My second, America's dream, still alive, battered, bullied, crawls to sweet justice.
Lovely, Wheezy. Thank you. Very good. Senryu, yeah. Okay, so if you look in the chat, Wheezy, you'll see some information about your...
Oh, am I still, am I muted? I just wanted to say, I've enjoyed everybody, but Sue, it just was so wonderful. What Sue read there, I mean, she, I don't know, is she an act? Are you an actress, Sue?
She's now.
Yeah, it was great.
Possibly. Thank you. Thank you, Wheezy.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for that, Wheezy. Thank you. Next, I'd like to invite Jen, please, our September feature.
Hi. Okay, this is still rough, especially the ending. So if anybody has suggestions, I'm totally open to it. No home sweet street for me. Leaving home is only bittersweet if you have some place else to go. Otherwise, it's just eviction, and there's nothing sweet about that. Otherwise, it's just called homelessness. And I dreamed that dream too often. Dreamed far too often of a home without my mother's care, of a cardboard flat pillow and a secondhand stuffed rabbit to keep me safe at night. And nothing would be safe, dried out attic in the rain, another mentally ill nobody. There would be nothing I wouldn't do, no trick I wouldn't trade standing.
Word.
Mm-hmm.
Jen, sorry to interrupt you.
Sanity would be on an offer, not that the plate was on the table, but a half-eaten bag of fries greased through and forgotten by a table taken hooky. If I was truly Section 8 put an end to those nightmarish days. Mm-hmm.
Jen.
Yes?
Jen, sorry. The audio is really, really bad. Can you guys hear me? The suggestion is if you turn off your camera, but keep the audio on, if you turn the video off, we might get a better audio. So can you try that again for us and start over?
Okay. Can you guys? Yeah. Can you guys hear me now?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Damn it. I'm talking right now. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Sorry, I was messing around with Zoom. No home sweet street for me. No place else to go. Otherwise, it's just eviction. And there's nothing sweet about that. Otherwise, it's just called homelessness. And I had dreamed that dream too often. Dreamed far too often of a home without my mother's care, a cardboard flat pillow, and a secondhand stuffed rabbit to keep me safe at night. And nothing would be safe, dried out addict in the rain, another mentally ill nobody. There would be nothing I wouldn't do, no trick I wouldn't trade for sanity. Not that sanity would be on offer, not that that plate was on the table, but a half-eaten bag of fries greased through and forgotten by a table at Steak and Hoagie, if I was truly lucky. Section 8 put an end to those nightmarish daydreams. And if I had to fight to get it, it was no mean thing. I waited 15 years to top that list, to get that welcome kiss from the County Housing Authority, full of possibility. When I moved in, blessing my ridiculous luck to be granted with so precious a thing as a roof, the breath I'd been holding in my amygdala released. And with it, fear. Fear of abandonment, fear of starving, fear of unwanted hands at night or in the daytime, fear of hoping for something better, fear of capsizing stability. I had been granted a gift past imagining for almost everyone who hasn't touched it. For everyone living in someday, in the lean years of maybe when. Foundational for those who sleep inside it. A home is a luxury without consideration for most. But to me, well, to me, that first snap of the deadbolt marked an epoch passing. Gone were the days of sharing space and fears of unhoused living. Home was where I could turn the key. Some months later, I sometimes bitch about cleaning dishes or taking out the trash. Sometimes I forget that bone-deep chill of the thought of the streets lingering, crotchety fingers on the front door, tapping, tapping, tapping. Sometimes it's easy to forget the disaster is patient. Only nowadays I know that homelessness isn't coming for me. I lay my head on a feather pillow at night with a locked door between me and the hallway. Thanks. Hopefully you guys heard that.
We heard that fine. Thank you.
Okay. Awesome.
Thanks, Jen. Okay, next up, please. Let's go with Mike.
Hello. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Jen. That was very powerful. And thanks, Phil. I loved all of your poems, and I can't wait to order a book and read some more. Really, thank you so much. It was wonderful. So one of the things we're keen to do with Words Out Loud is to extend just beyond poetry, and to invite people to share prose or, you know, extracts of things they're working on. I thought I'd have a go at doing something, just to sort of bring some of that in. So this is actually, I don't know what it is, you know, so I don't have a plan for this, but it is based on something that happened and then I thought about just beginning there. So it's somewhere here. There it is. So I guess it's got a working title. I've called it Daze, as in D-A-Z-E. And I'm just arranging the screen, and here it is. So it begins. Day one. Jacob was woken that first morning by a sound he'd not heard before, a loud pop, along with the shattering of glass and the swoosh of escaping air, much like occurs when a light bulb is smashed, and the sound of water too, slushing together with the sound of breaking glass. He'd been sleeping peacefully, or so he thought, and as he lay there for a few seconds, his mind calculated the possibilities in the bleary sort of way one would with a foot in dreamland and a foot in the waking world. Gunshot? No, too wet, and far too dramatic, you silly sod. A blown fuse? There'd be no glass. Something's fallen in the kitchen. Of course, that's it, he concluded, as he sat upright in bed and swung his feet round to get out. And that's when he saw it. Or rather, that's when he felt it. A shattered glass right underneath his feet, the water it had been faithfully holding, splattered up the bedside table and over the 4-pin extension plug that was untidily providing juice for his mobile phone. Now you might think that Jacob stepped on the broken glass or was given a jolt from the 4-pin extension lead, but no, it wasn't that kind of sensation he felt. It was a murky, swirling stab in his gut, the feeling of dread that one might be assaulted by at the sight of an omen forecast long ago and since forgotten. Today, he thought to himself, is going to be one of those days. Thank you. I don't know what it is and what it will be.
Great, Mike. That's good. Thank you. That worked beautifully. Thank you. Okay. So now I would like to invite Paddy Sullivan, please.
Hello. Can you hear me okay?
Yes. Got you loud and clear.
Okay. For some reason or other, we don't know how to make our picture turn up on the screen when we're reading. It happened the other day at a reading as well. Is there something we're supposed to do?
I don't know. I really don't know. What view do you have in Zoom? We can see you perfectly well. Are you on gallery view or speaker view?
Are we supposed to click on our little picture to make it bigger?
You can click, if you go to the view, in the top right-hand corner, there's view. And if you click on that and go to speaker, then you will be in the center of the screen and the rest of us will be on the top.
Okay, I did that and I'm still a little tiny picture, but that's okay.
Okay, sorry. I can see you in full screen, so.
Oh, you can, okay.
Yeah, I can.
We're looking at you. Hi. This is a short poem that just came out in Salt. And it's, I wrote this for our mutual friend, a lot of us know, Glenna Lushai. She hasn't heard it yet because I wrote it before she had her stroke, and we haven't visited her yet. So it is called Hello, Young Lovers. Our octogenarian friend arrives late, pauses at the door to take in the room, silently announcing herself, turned out in luxurious silk, velvet gloves, jewelry and fur hat, hair and makeup, sending out a slightly askew vibe, almost breathless, as if she'd just gone two rounds in the back seat of a 59 Cadillac Coupe de Ville. Thank you.
Thanks, Patty. Lovely to hear you. Thank you.
Thank you.
That means it's Tina. If you unmute yourself, we'll hear you.
Sorry, I lost you totally then.
That's okay, there you go.
I've got a piece of, it's a prose poem actually to read. And it's a piece that I did for, I did a seminar with Portsmouth University a couple of weeks ago with Pens of the Earth, which is a sort of environmental stroke writers and artists group in Portsmouth. And I wrote a short story after the workshop. And this is a kind of tiny snapshot of the story. So it's called Mrs. Peters. All is quiet in the city street. Just an ordinary street, really. Smallish houses, each with a tiny patch at the front. A little scrap of land to call your own. Some use it to store bikes. Others just leave the bins there to save dragging them out from the alley every week. Most have paved over the front for ease, convenience, and less fuss. And then there's number 44. Number 44 is different, stands out from the ordinary others. Roses and jasmine trail the faded, chipped, sandy brick walls. Their heady scent fills the air and makes the postie breathe in with pleasure and close his eyes just for a moment. Baskets of pink and purple petunias sway gently in the warm summer breeze. Tubs of red and white geraniums colour pop the grey pavement. Clumps of rosemary grow as fast as witch's hair and frame the bright blue front door with tiny purple flowers scented with remembrance and promise. Plump hydrangeas swell like big pastel balloons, pink, white, and blue. Contented bees hover and hum over fragrant lavender, whilst pretty cabbage whites and the odd tortoiseshell petal dance in the early morning sunshine. Number 44, a little patch of magic on a city street. Mrs. Peters waters it daily with collected rainwater and a smile. Her cat sleeps peacefully in a slice of golden sunlight as she sweeps the front purposefully with her birch broom. Little secret, she's a witch. I didn't put that in there.
Thanks, Tina.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much. Okay, so I think everybody's done, except me. So I'm gonna do a little one. If nobody else wants to read, yell if you do. So I'm gonna do one. Last time I think I did something about, didn't I do the second law of thermodynamics? So basically carrying on a sort of physics theme, this one's called chatter. I've been talking to myself lately. And it's not just because I don't usually answer back. I'm not really asking questions as much as giving a commentary on, well, anything. For example, I'm wondering if time is continuous, like a flame, or if it's fragmented, contiguous, like frames of a movie. And how would you tell, anyway? Someone asked me yesterday if the Big Bang wasn't really the end rather than the beginning, and I couldn't be certain. It seems to depend on whether time's going backwards or not, I suppose. When I say to myself that I don't seem to exist in a shared paradigm, I'm not sure if that's a good thing or not. Because who else cares? And what's important about sharing, I wonder? People can see the same things as different and think different thoughts simultaneously, generated by the same stimuli. That's odd, surely. Why does it work like that? And having spent most of my life encouraging young people to think differently about stuff, I wonder what those same people are thinking right now. I've never managed properly to get my head around the fact that everything is going on everywhere at the same time. These conversations on a one-way street run against the flow of my general train of thought and lead me to the conclusion that I probably should not have the presumption to write them down. So there you go. So look, once again, thanks to Phil for a fabulous reading and the promise of a book. We love it. Thanks to all of you and to those who had to rush off to do something else. Thanks to everybody. It's wonderful to see you all, and it's even more wonderful to hear you all. And we have the promise of another book from Tina. So we've got the promise of two books, which is brilliant. So fantastic. Those of you who are here, we will meet on the 1st of September in the coffee shop. Those of you who are further afield, we will meet on the 15th of September to listen to Jennifer. In the meantime, be careful, take care, go safely. Love to you all.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Wonderful Bye. To hear all of you.
Thanks so much, Phil. Great. Thank you, everybody. Thanks, Ken.
Wonderful.
Thank you,
wonderful.
Phil. Bye. Everyone, stay Bye. Safe.
Thanks, Bye. Phil.
Bye.
Thanks, Ken.
Bye, Bye everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thank
Bye.
You.
Bye, everybody. Mm-hmm.